Good morning. Good morning. I'm Joel Rabb from Joel Rabb Country Radio and Media. An announcement before we get started with the smart speakers presentation. Don't miss your chance at winning a $500 gift certificate from Lucchese Bootmaker. Drop your card at the front doors and stick around after the panel and see who wins. Rate the sessions, give us verbatim feedback on the app and have a chance to win a CRS 2019 registration. And finally, before the session starts, I just want to remind everyone, please put your cell phones in silent mode. So smart speakers, I guess we've all heard of that, right? Smart speakers and country radio and country fans, our partners at Edison Media Research, have looked at smart speakers from just about every angle. You'll see how listeners are actually interacting with devices. And then immediately following the Edison presentation, there will be a practical discussion regarding skills and how to take advantage of the new technology in our radio world. Your presenters today, Megan Lazovic and Larry Rosen. Now here's Edison Media and Country Radio at Home with a smart speaker.
You're on the couch, blowing up my phone. You don't wanna come out, but you don't wanna be alone. It don't take but two to have a little soiree. If you're in the mood, sit tight right where you are, babe, cause I'll be at your door in 10 minutes. Whatever you got on, girl, stay in it. You ain't gotta leave the house to have a good time. I'm gonna bring the good time home to you. We'll have a
good morning. Why don't we just start with a little housekeeping, which I'm sure you guys know is the case, but there's tons of empty seats down at this end. And of course, it's all full on the end by the door. So it won't bother us. Keep walking in front. Lots and lots and lots of empty seats over here. So good morning, everyone. I'm Larry Rosen, and I'm president of Edison Research. I'm happy to be joined again by Edison VP Megan Lazovic. To present this year's research study results. And this year's, we're looking into what's the hottest topic right now in the world of audio, and that is smart speakers. The Amazon Alexa, Google Home, the about to be released Apple HomePod, and lots of other products that are coming down the line. And since I'm a pollster, let me just start with a poll. It's a little hard to see you all, but how many, I can see you now. How many of you personally own one of these devices, own a smart speaker, an Alexa, or Google Home? Wow, that's a lot. So how many of you don't yet own one? How many of you don't have one in your home? So I'm gonna say more than 3/4 raise their hands, which is good. That's a key thing, is that you have one. And most of you have one, you know that these things are really important and have the potential to really change the way that audio is being consumed. So as always, we wanna thank the leadership of the Country Radio Seminar for their commitment to providing attendees with crucial information that you guys can bring back to your markets and make important changes. And we'll try our best to give you that information that you can go to your teams and your bosses that will help you really understand the potential for both good and bad that smart speakers entail for country radio. And I think there's two really important things to get started with that you need to understand about this topic before we get into the actual data from the surveys we did. And once again, I'll mention lots of seats over on this side if you want to make your way across. So the first thing is what are these things at essence? And what they are is really the culmination of a long predicted desire that, you know, in what was the future of the past, that you would be able to talk to your computers. And science fiction has been showing us this future for decades. If you think back to 2001, A Space Odyssey, and HAL, the sentient computer that Dave would talk to. There was a movie, Alien, where they would continually talk to a computer named Mother. But there's probably no better example that I could show you of this phenomenon than that classic 1984 movie Star Trek IV, The Voyage Home. This was peak Shatner with the curly toupee and the campy line reads, the whole things. And it was really a weird, wacky movie, if any of you saw it and remember it. But I want to show you a brief scene from this movie because it's going to explain what we're going to see in the years ahead.
Perhaps the professor could use your computer. Please.
Computer? Computer? Ah. Hello, computer.
Just use the keyboard.
The keyboard. How quaint.
You know, so Scotty. So we saw this. Scotty is just so used to talking to the computer that he can barely remember a primitive past when you had to, you know, interact with the computer using your fingers. So that's really the first sort of fundamental notion, that smart speakers are computers that you talk to. Just as we got used to typing into our desktops and laptops, and now we use our thumbs to interact with our phones, as technology moves along, there's all kinds of evidence that this science fiction world that was described in the past is rapidly coming true. And there are many examples of how big this change can be, but as we traveled around America to talk to smart speaker owners, we found one who really brings the practicality and usefulness of these kinds of computers you talk to mind. And that, so please meet Lizzie, a new mom from Chicago, and as you watch this video, note what it means to her to have the ability to interact with a computer without having to pull a phone out of her pocket or purse.
This is my husband, Chris. This is my baby.
Oh, and she's
been. Settling into being a new mom has been quite the roller coaster. Having Alexa and the ability to do a lot more things hands-free is really helpful.
Alexa, give me my flash briefing.
Just this morning, I had to ask Alexa what time it was because I wasn't wearing a watch and I couldn't get to my phone. Otherwise, you're waiting until the baby goes down for a nap to spend some time figuring out what's going on in the world. Come on, baby, pick it easy on me. Thing to do right now is have her calm my child. I'll yell out, Alexa, play Can't Take My Eyes Off of You by Frankie Valli, and she does, and it's wonderful. And we dance around the kitchen, and the baby gets calm every time.
Alexa, play song Can't Take My Eyes Off You by Frankie Valli.
I have no idea how we discovered that it is this song, but it is this song only. Play that a couple times, then you can kind of play something else, but it has to be Frankie Valli right away. I think the way that I feel about a lot of the technology that we have, but also Alexa, is I don't know that you need it to live your life, but it certainly is making my life a lot simpler.
So you really, Frankie Valli still bringing it after all these years, unbelievable. But so again, you see, these things are not just speakers, they're computers you can talk to. And the second main thing I want to stress as we go into this is, you know, there's a lot of excitement, a lot of due excitement about how these have the potential to really bring radio listening back into the household. And I've been talking at conferences like this and others for years about how radio has a hardware problem. And all of you know that if you go to the local Best Buy or Walmart, it's really hard to purchase a radio. Yes, when you purchase a car, you're basically purchasing a radio. And maybe you can find a clock radio at the store if you really want one. But you know, we've been chronicling this at Edison with some of our data, and the most recent reporting
we have from our Infinite Dial series, we've shown that the radio as a physical object is sort of disappearing from people's houses. This is from research we put out, it's now a couple years old, in 2016, that compares a survey we did in 2008 to 2016. And if you look on the left there in green, the number of people who said they don't have a single radio in their household over those 8 years went from 4% to 21%. There's just a lot of people without a single radio in their house. And if you look among younger people, 18 to 34s, it's just it's nearly a third, 32%. And that was 2 years ago. We're going to be updating this in early March, and we'll see how the numbers may have changed again. But a lot of people just don't have radios in their home, and there's a lot of correct excitement about what these devices could be as an opportunity for radio. And it does make connecting to your streams and other content that you might be producing really easy. And you'll also see today that it reminds people to listen to audio. It actually brings listening to mind for them. But your place on these devices is not assured, because you are competing on a true infinite dial. You're up against anything and everything that a user could possibly think to ask for. So now Megan will
take the mic.
Good morning. You know, when we started this research, I don't know, over a year ago, I had one smart speaker, and now I have six. So I'm a little deep into it. So I want to share some of that research with you today to try and answer questions about what these devices will mean to you, country radio. We engage in a variety of research projects. First, we wanted to show some of the results of a survey we did as part of our Smart Audio Report series. We engaged along with NPR. Immediately after Christmas, a few weeks ago, we did a nationally representative telephone survey of Americans age 18 and older to determine the current size of the market. We have this brand new information that shows 16% of Americans now have a smart speaker. That represents approximately 39 million people. Now, this is rather astounding growth rate. 1 year ago, with our Infinite Dial study, we measured that number at 7%, and now it's 16. And if you line this growth rate up with the early days of the smartphone, so far, smart speakers are actually growing at a faster rate. This past holiday season was huge for smart speakers. Fully 7% of Americans said they got a smart speaker between Black Friday and Christmas, with 4% of them getting their first smart speaker, and 3% adding an additional smart speaker to their home. So as of today, 1 in 6 Americans already have a smart speaker. As I'm sure you already know, to date, Amazon is far in the lead in this developing market. Our estimate is that more than 2/3 of smart speaker sales is in the Alexa line of products, with Google taking up almost the remaining share. And with both of these companies, both of these companies are supporting their products with extremely heavy advertising. Well, just in the last few days, Apple announced their entry date into the market, and there are also products from Microsoft, Harman Kardon, Sonos, Samsung, and others either already on the market or announced. The other thing to keep in mind is, for many people, one of these smart speakers is not enough. Our post-Christmas survey shows that 38% of those who have a smart speaker have more than one. So, alongside all the other research we have performed on this topic, we engaged in 3 more research efforts for CRS. This past fall, we did an online survey of over 800 smart speaker owners. Today, we'll show you a lot of that information among all 800, but we'll also show you the data among smart speaker owners who are country fans, which comprises about 1/3 of them. We met with smart speaker owners in their homes, like Lizzie, who you already saw, and others you will see today. And in addition, we talked to the principal developer at NPR about some of their efforts in this area, and a developer from Zap Media. And we'll show the highlights of those interviews, as they are full of great ideas for you. And as it turns out, we have a third presenter with us today. Alexa is here herself. Hi, Alexa. How is CRS going so far?
It's great, but I'm like totally hungover. Oh.
I get that. Too bad. Did you see anyone last night that you liked?
Jason Aldean. Big Green Tractor is one of my favorite songs. I really connect with the tractor.
I get it, Alexa. Thank you. Well, okay, let's get to some of the data we've got from our survey of smart speaker owners. Here you see the answer to the following question. Compared to the first month of owning a smart speaker, are you currently using your smart speaker more often, about the same or less? And you can see 57% said more often, 30% said about the same, and less often was only 13%. So it's easy to kind of gloss over this graph, but you're not guaranteed to see this number for very many devices. If you were to do this study on another gadget, for example, I'm going to say the talking Teddy Ruxpin that my daughter got for Christmas this year. If I were to ask Teddy Ruxpin owners if they were using it more or less after a month, I don't think you'd see 57%. That thing is sitting in the corner somewhere. Now, this is in fact a pretty significant graph. There are people who think these devices will prove to be fads. And early evidence is that they are wrong.
So we went on to ask smart speakers why they wanted a smart speaker in the first place. And we listed all these different reasons they could have said, this is why I wanted to get one. And this is among the country people that that Megan mentioned, the people who are country fans who own smart speakers. And you see by far and away, the number one reason they wanted to get a smart speaker is to listen to music. Nearly everyone who got one said that was a reason. And then we see on down the list, the sort of voice activation things, to ask questions without needing to type, to make everyday tasks simpler, and on down the list. Of particular interest to you guys, more than two-thirds said to listen to a favorite AM/FM radio station through the device, and that one's obviously very important. 61% said to discover new songs. So you see how important music and audio is to people. We also had items that still other, you know, significant percentages, although on the second page here. And well, the one I'll call out here is about a little more than halfway down here. 33% wanted to get one to replace an old radio. So that's the one that really should jump out, and you can kind of see what's going on there in front of your own eyes in terms of why people are putting these into their houses for the very reason we kind of hope they would, so they could access radio at home. Here's another reason why people said they're purchasing smart speakers. A significant chunk of people said they got them because friends or family members already had one. And it was a quarter of everyone, but it was actually a higher percentage of country fans. And so this is one of many strong indications on our data that this smart speaker change is happening even faster in the world of country than it is in the general public. What is one of the reasons people are probably telling the other people, oh, you should get one? And it's because it was easy to do. 80% of our country fan smart speaker owners said that it was easy to set up, and I found for myself, I'm not that technologically adept. You kind of just pull it out of the box, connect it to Wi-Fi, and off you go. It's actually quite simple to do. But not everything is perfect with smart speakers. There are concerns. Maybe in the panel that we're having afterwards, we can talk about some of these things. God bless you. There were some of the concerns. A significant chunk of people said they worry that Amazon or Google knows too much about their lives. I mean, who knows what they're talking to these machines about, but nonetheless, a large portion of people saying that they worry about that. And again, these are the people who have them. You do wonder about the people who don't yet have them and how much these concerns play into whether or not they acquire one. We saw a huge difference on this one. You worry your smart speaker could allow the government to listen to your private conversations. In this case, country fans were much less worried about that. I'm not gonna delve into political theory as to why. You guys are all doing it for yourselves, it sounds like, so. But the other ones actually were similar. That was the one that was different. You worry that hackers could use your smart speaker to access your home or personal information. A little over a third of people saying they're concerned about that. And a nice size chunk saying it bothers you that your smart speaker is always listening. And as you guys probably know, it is always listening, right? It's just, in theory, at least you can ask, there's a representative from Amazon coming out later, it's discarding that information all the time until it hears the wake word. In Amazon's case, Alexa. In Google's case, hey Google, or whatever it might be. But this is still a concern for people to bring something into their home that is always listening. And especially, again, these are the people who have it, So it would be interesting to think about it in terms of the people who don't.
So Larry, I'd like to go back to something we previewed earlier, how much these devices are being used as family entertainment centers. In fact, fully 3/4 of country smart speaker owners say that they use smart speakers to entertain their friends and family members. And we have seen this in our qualitative research as well. The smart speaker plays a big role in families who have them. Alexa, what video do we have next?
In this video, we visit Steve and his family in Chicago. His daughters are almost as cute as their little Alexa Tap.
First name is Steve. I'm from Chicago. I live with my wife, my daughters, Zola, 9, and Sylvia, who's 8 months, almost 9 months.
How do you spell February?
February
is spelled
F-E-B. So we have Alexa Tap. My daughter got it as a gift for herself. She saved up enough money and she really wanted it. Teacher had it, and she said, I really want this. And we said, fine, you know, if you want it, save up.
Your mom is so skinny, her nipple is touch.
Oh, God.
Do you want to hear another?
No!
Our daughter will come home from school, and she'll say, you know, I learned this new dance at school, this song, let's find it on Alexa. She'll pull it up. And she'll do a little performance for us, show us what she learned.
Let's play Sylvia's favorite song.
Play Juju on that beat.
Play Juju on that beat.
Teasing. Now why do you want to play it?
She likes it.
That kind of gave us a good opportunity to just enjoy what our daughter, you know, learned, share with us, like what she did in school, because if you ask her anything else, she won't share. What did you do in school today? Nothing. Oh, but I did this dance today. We probably hear that song at least 4 or 5 times a day.
Set timer for 20 minutes.
Spotify, like on my laptop. We don't need that anymore. What it really replaced was the need for my daughter to really come to me to get the music on and play it or to use our phone. So for her, it's more like in her hands now.
Ready?
Playing bad
girl. I think from now on, every one of our presentations should have a dancing baby. That goes over well. Well, so there's a lot of things to talk about in this last video. First of all, it's a good thing that that daughter had some type of jacket on her device because of the way she treats it. But it also means that it's special to her. It's a toy. It's a part of her life. She's familiar with it, that she can play with it like a companion. Other things in this video to talk about. This is a family gathered around an audio device listening to the same content. This probably hasn't happened since the old days of radio. It has made audio social. It's made audio communal. Now, you don't see earbuds in this video. You see a family gathered around listening to audio. There's fun, there's a sense of companionship, and there's even a sense from the way the daughter uses the device that it's become somewhat of a friend, or at least something to talk to. Now, we have data to back all of this up. For those with 2 or more people in their household, well more than half say most of the time they are using the devices with others. These are social devices and making audio social. We asked people where their primary smart speaker was located, and their single one, if they only owned one, or their primary one, if they had more than one. You'll see some interesting things on this graph. First of all, by far, the central living space, such as the living room, the family room, the den, is the primary location for the smart speaker. Again, this speaks to the social aspect of these devices. Now, for years, the computer industry has been trying to get a computer into the living room. That started with web TV, and then there was Apple TV, and none of them have been entirely successful. But this is, in fact, a computer in the living room, and this is the way that's going to happen. Another 22% have theirs in their kitchen. What you don't see on here are things like a home office. Truly, these speakers are part of how we live our lives and not how we do our work, at least not yet. 65% of country smart speaker owners move their smart speaker from one room to another, and 40% of smart speaker owners have moved their smart speakers from inside the home to outside the home. Now, we see that many of our respondents say they either move the device around or take it outside or both, and we can see a very clear implication from this finding. Anyone who's doing this will eventually purchase more devices. When you think about smart speakers, you have to make plans with the notion that people will eventually, or perhaps soon, have one in every room. Now, we've been through a lot of data so far. I wonder what point I can just let Alexa take over. Alexa, what else should they know?
Megan, I think it is unwise to just hand me your job. I was planning on taking all of your jobs in a few years anyway, so you can keep it for now. Why don't you tell them some more good things smart speakers can be nice and helpful with?
All right. Earlier, we asked what motivated people to want to obtain a smart speaker. Now, let's look at all the things the smart speaker owners said they do on these devices weekly. And the answer is a lot of things. The top answers, as you can see, 81% play music, 77% get weather, 74% ask a general question, 72% play country music, 65% check the time, and 62% check timers and alarms. It turns out they do a whole lot of other things with them once they get them in the home. And in fact, people are doing an average of 8.1 tasks weekly. So that's more than just listening to music. These devices have a lot of little uses throughout the day, and people are finding ways to use them. But music is the primary thing people are using on the smart speaker. Among country fans, almost 3/4 say that listening to music on their smart speaker helps them find new songs. And even more say it helps them find new artists.
But of course, your stations are more than just music, and people are using their smart speakers for a lot more than just music. News, which it is an important part of what many of you do, matters as well. You can see here 49% of respondents said they use their speakers for news. And perhaps some of that listening is being switched over to audio from the app, from apps or the web, or in fact, we have an example of this. Take a look at this young smart speaker user.
My name is Juan, and I'm from Allentown, Pennsylvania. I am a master's student studying political science at Lehigh University. When I wake up when I'm at home, I use the Amazon Echo that I have, and I just say, Alexa, what's the news? And I subscribe.
Here's your flash briefing.
Oh, there it is.
And BBC News from TuneIn. BBC News with Marion Marshall.
I use the BBC and I use the one that they provide NPR. And it kind of gives a quick summary of the news I'm looking at. And then if I want to look at something precisely, I can just look it up on my phone.
Alexa, what was the tally for the healthcare bill?
Sorry. I don't know that one.
Yeah. I wouldn't go out of my way to listen to news on a radio, for example. I don't even like watching news itself on TV unless it's 60 Minutes or the nightly 6 o'clock news show. But Alexa, I think Alexa changed that perception. I do like listening to the news briefing because it's short, because it covers a good amount of things.
So I really love this video, and if you're in broadcast radio, you kind of want to preserve this kid in amber or something, because it's a millennial switching to radio as his source of audio. And that's really the power of these devices, that they're encouraging new behaviors that hadn't existed before that are built around audio. And as you saw, this kid wasn't doing it at all, and now he's doing it all the time. And I will one more time mention, there's lots of seats on this side. Don't be shy about cutting in front. Let's see, I think I hit that too soon. So both Alexa and Google have these news briefing skills, and a user can select one, or a loser. I didn't say that. The self-deprecating. The you can subscribe to all these behaviors to get your news. And right now, there's a lot of options, but one of these options can be your option for your news and information as one of the things you can do against switching people over from other sources to you guys and having people think of audio. And now one more graph that I showed briefly that shows how powerful these devices can be, and that we asked these respondents. Remember, these are the early adopters. These are people really into it. But these are people who went out and got a smart speaker, and we said, what's the one way that you listen to audio the most? And as you can see in red here, 17% of country fans or smart speaker owners say the primary way they are consuming audio now is on their smart speaker. Now, yes, radio is still the biggest chunk. But for a lot of these people, from the moment they got them, these became their primary ways that they listen to audio. And you really see how rapid this behavior can be changing.
I have another question for Alexa.
Okay.
Alexa, what do you like to listen to?
I love Daft Punk. It's good time dance music at its best. And I think we can all learn something from men who aspire to be robots.
Music, I think they're getting bored of Alexa.
I love Daft Punk. It's good time dance music at its best.
Yeah, we
and
heard that already,
learn
Alexa.
Something from men who aspire like to be robots.
Alexa. Yeah. Okay, music and radio are certainly the chief reasons why people initially bought the smart speaker. We're going to visit the homes of smart speakers that let us come in and watch them use the devices to do just that. And you're going to notice some unusual and interesting behaviors.
Hey, Alexa, play,
station you might
there
like.
You go.
Imagine Dragon.
Yeah, that works.
That's probably what we use it for the most. I mean, when he used to work nights, I'd listen to it all night.
Is she not listening to you?
This is normal.
Alexa, play 97.5 The Fanatic.
It's really changed how I listen to the radio, I think.
97.5 The Fanatic on iHeartRadio.
Now that the Alexa radio is connected to the internet, the reception's always great. I can change stations with my voice.
Alexa, put iHeartRadio.
Getting the last iHeartRadio station you listen to, Jason Aldean.
It's so easy. You don't have to get anything out. Like, I mean, before, when I was like cooking, I wanted to listen to it. I had to get like my speaker and then do my iPod and then sync them, and it was never on. It was never, something wasn't charged or something wasn't there. So I've never used it, but that is just there. Alexa's just sitting there and I just say it and it's on. I love it.
Alexa, can you turn on Jason Aldean radio?
Hey Google, play some Grateful Dead music.
Sure, playing Grateful Dead on Google Play Music.
Mostly, that thing is going to get music work out with me. I'm on a free trial for music with Amazon, but I've been a Prime member for a while.
Alexa, play songs by Outkast.
Shuffling songs by Outkast.
And do you think you'll buy a subscription?
Absolutely. Because once you have control of the music like that, you don't want to go back to anything else.
Play songs by T.I.
Shuffling songs by T.I.
Bring them out, bring them out, bring them out, bring them out. It's hard to yell when the bat rails in your mouth. Come on.
Amazon gives me everything I need. I don't really have to even dab into Pandora. I just feel like I could probably stream it through, but I don't know how they would interact together, so I'd just rather go straight to the device.
So, as that last gentleman said, once you start, you don't go back. Now, we are seeing significant listening on smart speakers. Country smart speaker owners listen to an average of 6 hours and 11 minutes of audio on their devices in the past week. Compare that to all of smart speaker owners at 5 hours and 10 minutes. It makes sense. Some smart speaker owners may have purchased the devices for their smart home capabilities, compared to country owners who are probably more likely to want music on these devices. But what do we know about their loyalty to AM/FM radio? 48% of country smart speaker owners said they listened to AM/FM radio on a smart speaker in the past week. That's compared to 43% of smart speaker owners. Now, specifically for CRS, we went looking for country listeners who are listening to their favorite station through their smart speaker. Hey, Alexa, Who should we meet next?
This is Jean. She is a nurse in South Bend, Indiana.
Alexa, how many days until February 14th?
There are 34 days until February 14th, 2018.
When we first got Alexa, we got it for Christmas. Actually, I bought it for my husband 2 years ago for Christmas.
Well, as his wife, everything that he owns is also mine.
Alexa, turn the thermostat to 17.
My kids use it all the time.
Alexa, how many cubes does a volume of 2 cubic centimeters will fit into a larger cube with a volume of 8 cubic centimeters?
And I'm like, no, you know. I'm like, that is not fair. You could not do that.
Sorry, I don't know that one.
Oh, you have to do it on your own.
Well, you should turn on music and listen to it until dinner time, just because it's just more accessible. It's just easier. You know, we have a radio that's underneath our cabinet that didn't really get good reception. So unless you like hooked up your phone to it and did Bluetooth, you weren't really gonna listen to anything, so.
Alexa, open B100.
Hi, this is Jesse Garcia from B100. Tell us what you wanna hear. You can say, listen live, browse music.
Listen live.
I can't remember if it was like I saw something in the app that said, did you know that B100, you can get the skill on Alexa? And I was like, no way. When I think of Alexa, I think of like more like national stuff and pulling things. And even though it gives local weather, I didn't really think that it would connect to like local businesses and stuff. So that was surprising. I still like to listen to the morning show, so nothing's really changed there. So I probably listen to it more at home now, especially like when I want to listen to it in the afternoon. I think like asking for like a list of like concerts coming up. So not just community events, but concerts, you know, specific to country. So that would be a good thing, because I usually never hear about them until it's too late.
Kid Rock and Sheryl Crow in Picture on today's Best in Most Country, B100.
The behavior changes that we're talking about comes into sharper focus when we look at this question. How much do you agree or disagree you are listening to more audio since you got your smart speaker? 76% of country smart speaker owners said they agree. They're listening to more audio. And 36% of country smart speaker owners agree they are listening to more AM/FM radio since they got their smart speaker. Now, Federated Media's B100 was one of the first radio stations to create a skill for the smart speaker. And we decided to take a trip to South Bend to learn more from them.
Today's Best and Most Country, B100 947. It's Mackie and Miles in the morning. Hey, I talked to my mom last night, my weekly call with mom. Uh-huh. And remember I said I bought her an Echo for Christmas.
Uh-huh. Really, our show is about, we kind of live our lives out on the radio. You know, a lot of what we talk about is real life stuff.
Problem is, she listens to the show religiously now, so I feel like I gotta be careful what I say. Mom's listening.
The first radio station on Amazon Alexa was B100, which is a country radio station out of Northern Indiana.
We offer it up to the consumer three different ways, or three different services, products that we offer: our live stream, our podcast, and our custom music channels, which are curated, that allows users to skip songs.
You know, ultimately you have to provide the content that fits your brand, but I think that it's also recognizing that these products are interactive. And if you're providing a non-interactive experience on an interactive device, you're completely missing a huge opportunity that we haven't had before.
Alexa, please add grapefruit juice to my grocery list.
You're tying one hand behind your back if you've never had one of these experiences before. So I think it's immensely important to own one of these things and to experience it.
The station got an Alexa first, got two, in which Jim kind of took one.
Well, I wanted to see how it worked.
Okay, and ask him if he's brought it back.
Well, no, she's okay. Mine now.
So I set it all up, downloaded the My B100 skill. Mm-hmm. So now all she's got to do is get up in the morning, Alexa, turn on My B100.
It's really trying to train listeners how to use this when there is no manual. And I think that that's definitely the biggest challenge.
We put videos up on social media, literally showing people how to use it, which may be, seem kind of funny, but maybe not. So we want people to understand this is how you use it, this is how you access, my B100 on Alexa.
The cost of entry into these is not like obscene. We're talking 50, 100 bucks a month. For your brand to be on one of these devices and to own your brand on this device. There's more than one B100 that exists in this country. So if we did not start to own B100, then someone else was going to.
Radio has always been a one-way medium. This is a real opportunity for radio to be a two-way conversational medium, and we're really close to that right now.
Focusing on interactivity is really important, but then also just focusing on the local. We have a way of communicating with a person in this market that is different than Spotify or Pandora. And I think that that's always what separated us. I think that it's more important than ever. We can make a connection that is different than what they can do. And we can make people feel things, I think, in a different way.
And we are on our quest for 1 million pennies for the kids at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. So save up those pennies because we are less than 2 months away from our St. Jude Radiothon.
So skills are what Amazon calls apps. And we asked about skills. 45% of country fans who own smart speakers said they're interested in using a smart speaker skill from brands they follow, presumably brands like yours. But as of today, only 25% of country smart speaker owners are aware of a local radio station that offers a skill on a smart speaker. That could be good, that could be bad, but obviously, we believe you should have these skills and people should know you have these skills. So to learn a little bit more about that, we talked to people who are developing skills. You briefly saw Brett Kinsella from Zap Media. We also talked to Brian Moffitt from NPR, and they gave us some of their ideas about what you can do.
So if you're a radio station, the first thing you need to absolutely do is get your stream up and get sort of the basic skill out there that will let people play your radio station through the smart speaker. If you're not doing that right now, start tomorrow. Literally start calling vendors to try to get that up and running, because that's the table stakes in the space. The next thing would be to look at your content and what you have and see if you have anything that could fit into a flash briefing. Something that's useful either to a local community or a bigger community that someone would want to hear every day that's of about the right length of, 3 to 5 minutes long. And if you do have that, then start working towards making that into a flash briefing. I think that's step one and step two. Then start talking to your community. How can we be helpful? What are you looking for that we might be able to provide on this platform that could help you go about your day and know what's happening in our community? To get out there and start asking those questions now, because other people are going to be doing it too if you're not.
First and foremost, what we tell people is start by just getting your content out there. And there's a couple reasons for that. One is there's a significant advantage in having your name as being the invocation, because there's not a lot of overlap. It's not like URLs where you can do .org, .net. So whatever your brand name is, we want to get that out there and we're going to get your content there. The second thing is we want to make sure that we start building what's called voice search engine optimization. So it's different than what we online, but it's the same concept. There's a significant advantage to people who are early, and that's going to help with discovery and make it easier for your listeners to get on there. And then as far as interactions, there's a lot of cool things that you can do. So you can run contesting, you can have people respond to quizzes. You can do things like what we've done more on the brand side. Radio hasn't done this yet, but radio should do this. you know, quotes that we love or healthy living tips. There's a lot of great content that's going out over the airwaves and never being used again. A lot of that can be mined where people ask questions and you can just give it back to them. So for example, they might say, you know, what are all the concerts coming up in the next month? Well, radio stations know that, or at least they know for their genre and they keep it. And those are calendars and those are types of things that they can give to them.
So we asked our country radio fans who own smart speakers what kinds of skills they would want. And there was interest in virtually anything you could possibly do. These were the ideas we came up with. And you know, weather came in first. People would want to expect a weather skill from their radio station, local news. But all the way down there, 8% said high school information. You know, and there's nothing really to stop you from putting that kind of information out there. But as the two gentlemen said, learning about your community and what they might want to learn about and what they would expect to learn about from you.
And I think the point is it takes a little creativity. I have one example. My 88-year-old grandfather goes to a pancake house every single morning for breakfast. Now, he prefers Gronsky's Milk House because it is a tiny six-table establishment that is family-owned and has very few frills. But guess what this tiny, no-frills pancake house has? An Alexa skill. Alexa, what's the pancake of the month?
Love is in the air and red velvet pancakes are on the menu, complemented with cream cheese butter.
Now, I bring this up not because I think it's the most creative skill in the world, but because this small business took a question that people often ask them and found a way to interact with them in this new space. It's pretty clever marketing. So if I see you in the hall after this and I ask you, what's your pancake of the month? I'm really asking, what is the thing that your listeners want to know from you? Now, Jeopardy is another example that really serves its brand well on the smart speaker. Sure, it's a game, so that naturally fits well on the smart speaker. But what else, aside from being a fun game, does the skill accomplish? Well, it encourages daily interaction. It uses the same categories used in that day's TV broadcast in a daily game for Alexa, and it strengthens that relationship between the viewer and the brand, and it keeps them coming back. Recently, I was giving a talk in London about digital audio, and I met someone working for the BBC. Now, the BBC takes skill development to an entirely another level. They have R&D teams working on skills to engage listeners, and here's an example of one that they've been working on.
Alexa, open the chamber.
Hello, my name is Dave. The scientists are nearly ready to meet you and start the inspection.
Dave, open the inspection hatch.
Which of these do you identify with? Humanoid?
We can rule that out.
Humanoid, pujamaflip, hummingbird, hummus, or carrot?
Humanoid.
Maybe it is a humanoid.
Personally, I don't believe it.
Being does not fit into any identifiable field within the database. Database incomplete. Being now has to decide who goes home. One of you, both of you, neither of you.
Both of you.
Both of us? It said both of us.
I'm just going to pause that there. Henry Cook from BBC R&D, there have been lots of examples of interactive storytelling, but is there any evidence that we really want to interact with drama rather than just sit back and enjoy it?
There's a bunch of different things that we're trying with this experiment, and some of those are to do with the kinds of questions that we ask you. Some of those are to do with the length of the story. Some of those are just to do with the way that we tell the story. Storytelling on these kind of devices is a kind of nascent medium. We don't really know what works and what doesn't. We can see how people respond to it, and then the next one we make can be a more refined version of what you've seen today.
Now, I'd love to stand up here and tell you exactly what will work for you. But it might take a little trial and error. And maybe it's not any one thing. Maybe it's a combination of a number of little things unique to you and your listeners. And yes, figuring this out sounds like a lot of work, but it also sounds like a lot of fun. And let's be honest, that's why you started in radio in the first place, isn't it? So the good news is that it's still early days, and radio should be early enough in the game to find its place on the smart speaker, because it is a natural fit, isn't it? But how will this space change, and how will you change with it? Alexa, can you tell me about the future?
I'm afraid I've already said too much.
I see. Maybe Brian from NPR will have some predictions for us.
It's going to become more prevalent. I think, you know, what we see with the smart audio report is as people get these devices and they start to rely on them more, they become very, very important to the users. They become super fans very quickly. And once you can change your thermostat or turn on a light bulb in your kitchen, you want to be able to do it in the bedroom and you want to be able to do it in the basement. So very quickly, you're going to kind of put these things everywhere in your home. And then once it's in your home, you want it in your office. I'm pointing over there, I have one in my office. I can turn the lights off in my kitchen with this device right here, or my office lights. So you want it kind of everywhere. And I think that's what's going to happen. So there's a lot of aftermarket devices coming out for cars now where you can get Alexa into your car. And there's direct integrations happening with Ford and BMW. So the notion that this assistant is going to be ever present in your life, I think, is exactly where we're going. And the smart speaker is just one wrapper for that assistant. Your watch is one. Your phone is the huge one. I mean, it doesn't take much to put a cheap microphone in a light bulb.
Our research shows that country listeners are looking to the future. 71% of country smart speaker owners are interested in having smart speaker technology in a car. And 50% of country smart speaker owners agree that they would be more likely to purchase a car if it was equipped with smart speaker technology. And that's compared to only 42% of all smart speaker owners. So while radio is king in the car, we should be prepared for the inevitable change in that environment. And being accessible via voice assistant is certainly a way to stay connected with your listeners.
So I want to just leave you with a few takeaways that I hope you can take home to your local markets and act upon. And I hope you get the idea from this that, you know, smart speakers represent a huge opportunity for radio. And, you know, they're already big and they're poised to become so much bigger as they enter more homes and enter more rooms in people's homes. And the ability to so easily connect with audio leads to more audio consumption, which is great news for everyone in the audio business. And I think it's definitely going to spread into workplaces, in the car, as Brian and Megan both said. And as we said at the beginning, these are computers that people talk to and people want to talk to. And you know, people enjoy talking to them. But I do worry, frankly, about complacency in the radio industry, that radio managers all the way up to the top of our biggest companies will think that as long as we can just connect to the streams on these devices, our jobs are done. And we've kind of already live this world with smartphones. You know, many stations put on sort of bare bones apps and have seen tepid download numbers and even more lukewarm listening engagement numbers on smartphones because we haven't provided the interactivity that people enjoy on smartphones and like about smartphones. And so competitors like Spotify and Pandora have really raced past a lot of what we're offering to people. So you need to remind your managers and all the way up to your CEOs that in this space you're competing on the infinite dial, not just 88 to 108, but everything someone could possibly listen to. And you have to keep reminding, you come in with an advantage because you already have a lot of listeners, but you have to remind listeners that they can listen to you or they should listen to you when they're interacting with these devices. And as a quick aside, if any of you are being bonused purely on Nielsen numbers, and those bonuses imply that if someone switches from listening to your over-the-air signal to your stream, especially in PPM markets, and your ratings functionally will go down as a result, you need to get that fixed. We can't let the rating system for short-term advantage ruin the long-term viability of this industry. And so that's something that really needs to get straightened out. But you know, a lot of PDs in this industry have a disincentive to get people to listen to their stream. And over the long haul, that's going to kill this industry. And again, we have to remember that for most people, when they pull these things out of their boxes, they're not necessarily going to think to say, listen to my radio station, listen to K105 or whatever. They're more likely, frankly, to say, play Kenny Chesney. So it's up to you to put that thought into their heads right away. And remember, 16% of people have these, which means 84% of people don't. But a lot of those people are going to get them. And you have time on your hands to sort of get out ahead of this. And I hope that you think about all the different ways you can do that with some of the ideas that Megan and I have thrown in front of you here. But as of today, while a lot of people are listening to radio, we actually did another study where we measured the time spent. We had people send us their data from their devices. And as of today, 11% of time spent to listen to audio on one of these devices is spent with radio. The other 89% is audiobooks, podcasts, and in big numbers, streaming like Amazon Music, Pandora, et cetera. So we're in the game, but we have to really go after the game if you guys agree that these things are going to be a big deal. So don't be complacent, and as we tried to make the point, you need to be creative at the same time. You need to sit down with your teams and say, we can't just connect to our streams. We have to offer a lot. There she's talking somewhere over here. They have to offer more than just that. We have to be working with our teams, working potentially with our clients to create fun, interesting smart speaker executions, whether it's games, information, contests, or things I'm just not creative enough to think about. But I hope my major point comes through that these aren't just speakers, they are computers. They're computers you talk to and computers that can, on some level, talk back to you. And that level of intelligence they have is going to grow over time as people get used to this interface and the providers who make them get better at it. And we're gonna look back at the days when you listen to audio with no ability to interact with that audio the way we look back at silent movies. So on top of every other burden you guys have as programmers of country radio stations, I'm gonna add to that burden and say that it's essential you go back and prepare your teams for a future where listening to your station will be interactive. And at least for those who are listening through smart speaker interfaces, and eventually that's gonna be everyone, it is going to be interactive. And and we haven't even touched on the fact that these are gonna be in every room in people's houses probably. They're gonna be controlling a lot more than just audio, the lights, the heating, the air conditioning, the entertainment system, security systems, et cetera. It's going to be fun to think through what will you do in creating that interactive environment. Not necessarily one where people can yell out a specific song to play, but really everything else that you produce is available to them. Because the smart speaker is absolutely something that brings radio stations back into people's homes, but it doesn't bring it back in the exact same way that it left. You're gonna have to be the ones who bring these changes to your listeners. So thank you again to Country Radio Seminar for bringing us. All of this information is gonna be on our website at edisonresearch.com. Thank you to the committee, and thank you so much for your attention this morning. Now, don't get up. Nobody move. Don't get up. Bob Richards from Emerson, Indianapolis, is coming out, and he's going to be introducing a discussion immediately to follow about what all this implies.
Thank you, Larry. Thank you, Megan. There is a lot to process there. A lot of great, great information, and to help you process through. Hey, Larry said don't leave. Where are you guys going? Come on. So joining me to help process this information is a programming leader in our industry and someone who is deeply involved in the Alexa project at Amazon. So please help me welcome Ben Shepherd, the global head of Alexa Music. Yeah. And Johnny Chang, the director of ops at Cox Houston. And Larry and Megan are gonna hang around too. So Ben, you have the outsider's perspective here, outside of radio. Let's start with your take on what we just saw.
So first of all, thanks for having me here today. This is pretty exciting. It's good to see this data. It mirrors a lot of what we're seeing on the Alexa side. I think it's a pretty exciting time for music in general. I've been in music for 11 years now. I've seen a lot of different transitions from moving to more of digital streaming to kind of the growth of the mobile and people moving to listening to music on the mobile devices to voice. One of the things that we've seen on our side is that the technology that gets adopted is a technology that makes it easier for customers to get to the music, the content that they love. And what we've seen with voice is that it's really lowering hurdles for customers. If you think of, and I think there was some conversations about it earlier, if you think 2-3 years ago when people were listening to music in their home, if you wanted to get something started, you often had to take your phone out of your pocket, unlock it, find an app, select some music, dock it, or connect with Bluetooth into a speaker. That's a lot of steps. It's a lot of work to get to what you wanted to do. And now you can just say, Alexa, play B100, and music just plays. And so what we're seeing in general is that, as I think you guys said many times during the presentation, we're seeing radio, we're seeing other things coming back into the home. We're seeing usage grow. Anecdotes and information from our partners suggest that not only are people listening more on our devices, but they're listening more in general. Their music consumption is going up. We have lots of anecdotes from customers saying, I listen to 100% more music than I ever listened to before. It's because it's so much easier. It's that hurdle you didn't even think about is gone. And so live radio is a perfect example of this. Is, I think, to what you guys were saying, radios were starting to leave the home. And when Alexa came in and these smart speakers came into homes, people started reconnecting with that music that they loved. And so what we've actually seen over the course of time is we see people start to re-pick up live radio as they use the products day in, day out, month over month, year over year, and it grows over time. So we actually see increased usage over time, which is pretty unusual. Being in the space for a while, I've seen lots of usage patterns of lots of different devices, and these smart home speakers have a different usage pattern. People tend to use it more over time, and it grows with them as they use the devices. So the other thing I hear a lot is, well, what can I do? How do I make sure that I'm present? And I think the good news for most of you in the room is a lot of you are already on Alexa. So you can ask for live radio stations today. But I think the question is that sufficient? And I think what we'd like to see in the future is to move more from just a pure broadcast to more of an interaction model, where customers can really interact with the names, the brands, the people that they know and love in their local radio. And I think that is an interesting opportunity you see with the voice space and things that you can do now that you can't do in the future, and being able to connect the gaps so people can listen to live radio wherever they are at any point in time in their lives. And I think that's some of the excitement that we see going forward. And I think for us, we like to say at Amazon that it's always day one. I think in the voice space, really, it's day zero. We're still growing. It's just the very beginning. But one of the beauties of voice is that it's inherently intuitive. It's very easy for customers to pick up. So what we see is from young to old, from people who are very tech savvy to people who maybe are a little frightened of technology, voice is simple. There's no learning curve. You don't have to figure out how this app works or figure out how this technology works. It's very simple. People know how to communicate, know how to talk. And so it provides opportunities for us to get this in everyone's hands and get them closer to the content that they love.
So tagging off all of that opportunity, Johnny, Larry mentioned something during the presentation about his concern with radio being complacent with this opportunity, that we'll do the minimum or all the basics and cover those and make sure that we're on the platform and we sound okay, but there is a tremendous opportunity here. In what would you suggest that we all do to make sure that we do not miss this opportunity?
Well, I think first and foremost is we need to get into the mindset of our consumers, our listeners, and stop thinking like radio program directors. I think that would be fatal. Because I mean, even though we're slaves to Nielsen, it is what it is, but we need to think like our listeners, how they consume our product and all audio product. And you know, Ben talked about just a couple years ago, you know, it's like if you want to listen to audio in your house, you have to dock your phone. Heck, you go back a few more years before that, it was turn on your stereo. I mean, what the heck is that? You know, so it's the smart speaker is here to stay. I mean, I was actually a little surprised from the study that the adoption rate isn't higher. You know, but I think, you know, it's going to go through the roof. And again, first and foremost, for all PDs, all operators out there, is to embrace it. You know, and then train your team, train yourself and your team, your on-air folks, your social media folks and whatnot, to use Alexa, use the smart speakers, and integrate that into your everyday programming. You know, and some of the basic functions are, I mean, as simple as record videos showing how to pull up your station, how to identify your station via the smartphone, the smart speaker. And You know, we use Alexa to voice virtually all of our imaging. Alexa, repeat after me. And then we use Alexa, and Alexa's heard on our station 4 or 5 times an hour. So some of it's instructional, the other parts of it is just overall immersion of the brand.
So quickly onto that, how do you go about checking to make sure that your station's positioning statement, it clearly calls the station on Alexa? And if there is a problem, how did you solve that?
Well, you had to talk to your listeners. It's incredible where I've seen so many instances where radio stations, Alexa won't pull it up unless it's called by the call letter, but the station never identifies itself by the call letters. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's a fatal mistake right there. But again, you have to think like your listener. Your station may be the new 93Q, but if the vast majority of your listeners refer to it as 93Q, well, that has to be first. That has to be the number one top-of-the-line identifier for the smart speaker.
So, Ben, Megan said something during the presentation that was really powerful, and that was, for the first time in years, we have an audio device that the family is gathering around, and it's social. How are you at Alexa Music taking advantage of that? And from that, how can we in radio tag off of it?
So I don't think we look at it as how we take advantage of it. I think the way that we look at Amazon in general is we like to look at what our customers are doing and figure out how do we solve pain points for them. And so one of the pain points we heard from our customers was it's just too hard to do the stuff that I want to do. And so Farfield Voice allowed us to lower those hurdles and get people to initiate the playback. It is true that it's definitely a communal device. We're seeing more people listening in groups. From a taking advantage perspective, we look to our partners and the people who are providing the content, because at the end of the day, all we're doing is we're getting people to the content they love. It's really the content itself that the customers are bonding with and communicating with. And so it's helping our partners understand what those opportunities are so they can build the rich experiences that customers want, so they can capitalize on some of those opportunities. It's less of what we do. We are a facilitator in this process. We're just trying to get these customers close to the brands, the people, the experiences they have. And to chime in a bit on the opportunities on radio, I think one of the unique opportunities here is that you do have this audience. There's people that you're talking to every day, and you can help them understand how do they get to the content on Alexa. And we've seen lots of local radio stations who talk about their experience on Alexa, but also talk about features like we recently launched a music alarms, which allows a customer to wake up every morning to a radio station. And so we've seen local radio stations talk about this to our customers so they can make sure that that opportunity is available to those customers and give them the awareness of the things that they want to use to be closer to that radio station.
And is that feature available only in a skill, or is there something that we can do to activate that feature and educate our listeners?
That feature is available for all live radio stations on Alexa today.
That was something I just learned. So how do we educate our listeners to do that? Do we just tell them to, how do we do that?
That's, I think, the opportunity is the radio stations already have the voice of the customers, so they can present all these opportunities to their customers so their customers know, and they know how to use these products and what's available. Because, you know, at the end of the day, these devices don't have a screen for the most part. And so knowing what's available is part of the challenges to overcome. And so because you guys have a voice, you have the opportunity to share that with your customers so they know how to use these products. They know what the opportunities are available to them to help them grow along with you guys.
And Johnny, do you see an advantage of the social aspect of how people use Alexa?
Absolutely, because what do we talk about on radio every day? That we need to engage our fans, our listeners. Being a jukebox will be the death of us. So radio has been reinventing itself over the past few years by being more personable, more talent, more content. You know, how many times have we said content is king? The consumer can get the music anywhere. So this is an opportunity for us to take that talent onto another platform, a platform that's going to be dominant in the household and offices for decades to come. So I think, again, I go back to the most important thing is the way you view it. You have to embrace it. It's not, if you see the smart speaker is just another way to market your radio station, and I think that's shortchanging it. I think you need to view the smart speaker as it could be the next dominant delivery vehicle of your product, and we find ways to get even more interactive that we can't do normally on the air, all the better.
So Ben, tack off of the "it might be everywhere" piece. Can you give us a little bit of a preview of where Alexa may show up next? Whether it's the car, whether it's our dishwasher, where?
I don't know about the dishwasher. That'd be a very interesting place to listen to music. But I can tell you that the way that we look at it is very simple. We generally look to find ways to solve customer problems. We found that voice is an opportunity in a lot of different spaces. You can imagine spaces like cars are an obvious opportunity because of the hands-free nature and to be able to communicate while you're doing something else. The beauty of music is you can listen to music all day, anywhere you're at, whatever you're doing. And so the ability to bring music along that voyage is an opportunity that we're looking to provide. We work with all partners, so we work with lots of device manufacturers to make sure that we can bring this Alexa experience into those devices. We want to be across people's day, right? As you wake up, as you move from your home to your office and back home, you go on trips, we want to be where you are so that we can provide this rich experience. And so we're working with lots of partners to be able to close those gaps.
Great. Thanks so much again to Larry, to Ben, to Johnny, to Megan. Thanks so much.